Good morning, afternoon, or evening. You might not necessarily be watching this video when I'm filming, but I appreciate you being here. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work. We're going to spend a day in an auto repair shop fixing a whole bunch of cars. It's been crazy busy this week, so we're getting a lot done. We have a real good week going. Closing around 60 hours at the end of Wednesday. We're heading for a good week, so we got a few cars in the grass to take care of still, but I don't see any cars in the parking lot. So I'll have to tie in some clips of what we're gonna work on today right here. Got the catalytic converter in for this Kia, 2008 Kia Sedona. Now you got a pretty good idea what's gonna go on today. We got a cloudy, dreary day outside, but that's not gonna keep us from having a smile on our face, getting in there to learn a thing or two and have some fun. Stay tuned. Let's get started. We got the catalytic converter in for this Kia a day early. They didn't think it would come till tomorrow. They already popped the engine cover off, took her out of the box. We'll go over and have a peek at that in a second. First thing, gotta take this heat shield out of the way. Unplug the O2 sensor right here. And as the secondary one's in the pipe down below, I'm gonna unbolt that pipe. And then once the heat shield's off, some bolts on the cylinder head holder on, we'll be good to go. Right from Kia, the correct part. I like that. Look at how nice the welds are. Just about the same as my welds if you watch my project truck videos. Almost identical. Let's get started. All right, from underneath, we gotta take two more nuts off here. I took these off yesterday just to get the debris out of here. And what I like to do is I pull this flange off, I put a rag in a tailpipe and a blow gun and make sure I push any debris out of this cat. It looks physically okay in front. So there's no monitoring sensor behind that cat. It's a secondary cat, unmonitored. So it won't cause problems unless it's plugged. But I can blow air through it, so I'm golden. I had Bill put his greasy little hand over the front, blew a little shop air through without any effort. If you try to blow shop air in it and it pushes your rag and your blowgun out of the tailpipe, you got a problem. It's also a way to check whether it's a front or rear cat, because both of them can cause trouble. Usually the front cat takes the majority of the heat, but if the rear cat becomes damaged, it'll melt. So anyway, we're pulling some bolts out of here. There's a couple of 14s on a brace under here. Started pulling these bolts out. There's two here. You probably only have to take this one out, but I'm gonna take all three of these out just to make it a little easier. You know, like I said, it's easy week. So things have slowed down a little bit today. Luckily this cat arrived early because I was just about to start playing with the project truck and they said your cat's here, which is cool. Get this done, it'll take an hour or two probably. I'm gonna get some of these bolts on the exhaust manifold up here. I'm gonna get them from underneath. I'll show you a second. Don't hit your head, careful. Get some of those bolts from underneath because it's easier. And then after I take the heat shield off from up top, I'll just have a few more left from up top. Then I should be able to lift the cat out towards the hood. So we'll see how that all goes. That's my plan for right now. Gotta have a plan. I'm gonna break them loose by hand just to take it easy on my Milwaukee new ratchet there and not do any damage to it. And hopefully it'll be able to spin them out the rest of the way, which I think it will. They're not crazy tight, 25, 30 foot-pounds maybe. And I'm gonna take these bottom four off from here. This one stays working a while. It's my favorite Milwaukee ratchet so far. Three heat shield bolts, I believe, and a heat shield comes out. Set it down now. I'm not putting the O2 sensor out once I absolutely have to. We're gonna sneak it over it. And change that on the workbench. I think there's about four or five more 12 millimeter nuts, and I should be able to push the cat back off the studs and lift it out. See the back of that car? That's not nice. Got stickers, flip people the bird, says my other ride, your mom. That's not nice. Just because he, I guess he assumes his mom does that kind of thing, so everyone's done. I don't know. Just having a little fun while I contemplate getting my tools. Nuts are actually getting hot. It must be a little tight. They have a little bit of a locking style nut on there too. That's where the heat's coming from. They turn, but they're still snug. One more. I think. You can't really see them. Working by braille, you know, I do that sometimes. Did I mention this ratchet's really way better than my other one yet? I think I do. The old gasket just slides off the studs. I noticed too, these indents face out towards the manifold. So put it back on the same way and the hole should line up. Sometimes it's the angle of the dangle, that's a problem. But the studs are further out on the bottom. It has to go that way, right? You guys can't even see. Give me 23 minutes to figure this out. That's been the best O2 sensor socket I've ever had. SP tools. They make a lot of specialty tools too. Kind of like Lyle, but not as large, I don't believe. They said something about an O2 sensor. Let me go see if I got a new one. I want to brag, but this here is a brand new O2 sensor from Bosch. You know what? I'm gonna go ahead and put it in. That's how I took it out. Because the heat shield comes out pretty far and makes it a hassle to get your O2 sensor socket on there. So I'd rather manipulate the tin heat shield than try to manipulate my socket to get it in there, if that makes sense. But you don't have to do it my way. But I can only show you my way. There is no trick to that gasket. The only trick is that if it catches on any thread, on any stud, it ain't going on. So I played with it a little while, and once my grandma told me to stop, I stopped. And luckily I was done at that point. It was on. Now I got the pipe below, which makes it a little more struggle. I might have to lift this up and get that pipe out of my way. You know what I can do? I'll slip the studs into the pipe for now. And I'll have to take it back to, because the gasket's not in there. It fell off, of course. That's just how it works in the biz. It's not a catastrophe. It's more of an expectation. That was the hard part. Smooth sailing from here. cat. Reflexes like a cat. I still got it. Not that old yet. We're done underneath. Let's go ahead and button this under tray up. Put the heat shield on there. This thing's ready for the road. It wouldn't go over 30 miles an hour before. We'll see. These are a bear to torque, but pretty important. 36 foot-pounds. I mean, the ones I took off weren't all the same tightness, but that happens with anything that heats in it. Heats and cools to the same extreme as the manifold does. So. And that's why the torque spec's important. The torque spec will bring it to the threshold where, as the metal expands, the stud can stretch a certain amount, and as the metal contracts, it'll contract back and keep tension on the gasket. But it's not a perfect science, as is evidenced by all the vehicles out there that have a leaking exhaust and loose studs and broken bolts and stuff. But there's a lot going on with the heat cycling and all. It messes with all that stuff. So. Luckily, it's pretty close, because you don't usually see problems until you got a lot of miles. Let's get the heat shield on there and stop babbling. Sensor leads. I'll have to go back into these spring clips. Otherwise you end up with a melted harness and O2 code you can't figure out. Now, who am I kidding? Most shops would just put some O2 sensors in. But it'd be their fault that they got damaged, so. Alright, I'm gonna finish getting this snugged up. Plug a couple of O2 connectors in. Let's take this thing for a drive. Oh man, that's nice. Rob's gonna take this one for a drive for me and make sure it's good. He's the one that road tested this, said it wouldn't go over 30. He used to work at Kia, by the way. 2008 Sedona's next. We're just racking up the Kias lately. Really popular cars around here, Kia and Hyundai. And the customer range varies. I mean, we got customers that love them and take really good care of them like it was a Honda. And we get people that they don't even wash it. They barely want to put gas in it. Those are the ones with the most problems, and it shows how much maintenance matters. But in any event, this one's a little older, 2008. So we're gonna pull that in next when Rob takes us for a road test. 2008 Kia Sedona. Oh, I see evidence. Someone has had their greasy paws on it. Looks like the oil might have just been changed. Just a tiny bit over the full line, not enough to be concerned about, so that's good. Got new oil in it. Got a Kia battery, looks like to be fairly new. Let's get the scanner on here. It said it's severe vibration at idle. I didn't feel a severe vibration, maybe a little bit. Check engine light's on. The light comes on, it scares people, and they feel all kinds of stuff, like a race car driver that's in the lead with three laps to go. Same kind of thing.
Let's get in there and take a look.
All right. Fairly clean car.
141,194
loving miles. Let's fire it up.
I feel a motor mount already. It actually feels like it runs good, but I felt the motor mount like it jumped out of the chassis.
Quick way to test that, put it in gear, firmly on the brake.
Doesn't feel too bad.
All right, I don't feel any severely damaged motor mounts. Let's get these two talking, see what kind of codes we got. And
I must have turned it off when I put it away. Usually you just touch the button, it wakes up. But if you turn it off, you have to hold the button for about 3 seconds or so, 4 seconds, and it lights up. So we'll give these two a minute, and we'll come back and we'll go over the codes.
Well, we got quite a few updates. So I turned the air conditioning on and the fan wasn't blowing at me.
I reached down there and gave the motor a whack and the fan turned on. So needs a blower motor. I already put it on the list. So still waiting to get some codes. Apparently I didn't update this for so long now. There's a lot of them, I guess. Taking a little bit. Don't worry, it won't take you that long. I'm going to have to wait. And for you, it'll only be like 0.2 seconds more.
Look at Rob out there.
You tell a Kia guy there's a Kia in the shop, and he goes berserk trying to figure out what's wrong with it.
It's running okay right now, so I'm thinking intermittently it's not running that good. And someone else has already changed the oil.
Again, this is the Jimmy speculation channel. So my job is to try to figure out what's really going on here. Someone's been working on it. They did an oil change, tried to fix it with an oil change, probably maybe cleared codes, and they came back. But anyway, the codes are intake valve control solenoid circuit range, which is pretty common. Camshaft position over retarded bank one intake. Random misfire, crank position, cam position correlation, which that code sets because of the intake cam code. Cylinder 1, 3, and 5 misfire. So bank 1, cam timing, and bank 1 misfires. So that's, we can put all of that together as there's something going on with a cam phaser solenoid, or actual timing chain stuff. So we're going to have to go over this thing a little bit, look into these codes, see if there's any kind of bulletins, where else we're going to need to go with this. Maybe take a look at some timing issues, data PIDs.
All right, we're sending a report. You got to save it first and then share it with this tool. I think I mentioned that earlier. And then we're going to bring up some data PIDs for cam timing. All right, I brought off my camshaft control, engine speed, intake cam actual and desired on bank one, and intake cam actual and desired on bank two. They're not together here. Bank one, bank two. So basically what I want to do is I want to watch my bank one data PIDs for actual and desired and my bank two data PIDs for actual and desired. Matter of fact, I can combine them and we'll just put those four up there. Now, we'll try to watch them and see if they deviate from desired and actual. Right now it's running pretty good, so it's not doing what the problem is. If it was a worn out timing chain, it would not be intermittent. So when it's intermittent, then you lean towards a phaser or a solenoid problem, which is better for the customer, although phasers are not inexpensive to replace, not much less than timing chains. Solenoid would be much easier. So what we might be able to do is get permission to switch the solenoid from bank one to bank two and take it for a road test, see if the code sets on the other bank. That's probably the easiest way to go about it, since it looks like right now everything's performing as it should. All the numbers, actual and desired, are where they're supposed to be. Now if you had, this said 10 degrees actual and desired for that bank was 37, then you know you had a problem, right? That would set the retarded cam timing code. It would be very, very sad if that was to happen. So there's very minor deviations. That's not a big problem because there is some movement in the chain and the pulleys. That's where the 1/10 of a degree and stuff's coming in. So
Let me go up front and see if they want to try moving the solenoids around or how they want to go about this. Unfortunately, I know some people might not like the part swapping, but they may just want to put a solenoid in bank one and see what happens with that. But I'm going to go up front and ask them how they want to approach it. Because time is money too. A lot of people don't, I've mentioned before, people don't want to think about wasted parts. But sometimes that cam solenoid, $60. Fast and furious, bro. Sometimes a cam solenoid is $60, and a half hour labor is more than that. So you always have to weigh all those things. Let's go up front, see what we're going to do with this next.
Well, sadly, that's where the cam solenoids are. There's one right there. And there's one right there. So
you got to take the intake off to get to them. And we both can hear the chain making some rattling noises. And the valve covers are leaking. So this could snowball pretty rapidly. Someone's changed the oil already. Maybe probably to try to fix this problem, but it almost looks like someone might have had some of this stuff off. So we'll see what happens with this car. I don't have a very good feeling about it though, but he's also talked about the blower motor not working and things like that. So airbag lights on, TPMS codes, but there's no light for those. So I'll keep you posted. Oh, he drove this Kia Soul, run like a champ. So that one's done. See what's next. All right, we talked to Paul Harvey, and he said, oh yeah, I drove it till the oil light came on and ran it out of oil. And that's when it ran bad and all. And I checked the oil. I put over 4 quarts of oil in it. So he said it's just a third vehicle. It's a beater. It sits a lot. And he doesn't want to spend any more than the diag. So I told him, you put oil in it. I cleared the codes. It may run okay now that there's oil in it. Because that's what causes those codes. These things are sensitive to that. Not to mention, you got to change the oil. You got to check the oil. And you got oil leaks you probably should fix. So we're done with this one. I'm pulling it around and we'll see if there's anything else to do. It's starting to rain. 80% chance of rain today, they said. And they were not lying. It is raining. All right, guys. The bottom kind of dropped out this afternoon. I apologize. Kind of abrupt end. But I'll show you something cool. New body mount bushings. Oh, that's what I did this afternoon. That's what happens when you're having a really good week and everyone's not having as good of a week. But I don't blame them. It's only fair that everyone has a pretty decent week. So I got some work done on the truck. I got all of the body mounts in. Thanks for watching today's video, guys. Tomorrow's Friday. So we're going to be sure to get some things done and have some fun then, too. We already got a couple of jobs lined up for me tomorrow. So it won't be as limited. Today I only worked on a few vehicles. So it'll be better. Make sure you watch tomorrow, too. I hope I see you then, because you're awesome.